right? Now, what is the first condition of yours to go to the trip? You will ask, what is my budget? Because not everyone can afford to go to Goa immediately, right? What will you do? You will ask, what is my budget? What will other person say? How will you calculate what is the budget? You will calculate your travel expense, your bus cost, your stay, your food, your refreshments here and there, and you will come to a figure, 15,500 for 4 days. This is the budget which the organizer gives it to you. Now from your end, you should check if that 15,500 is good for you or not. Then you will decide, right? Now say you give the invocation, say you are interested to go to the trip. If I tell you we are going next week, next Friday, can you say yes directly?
No.
What will you do?
We have to plan.
You will plan. And will you ask someone? Will you ask your parents?
Yes.
Will you consult your friends?
Yes.
How the places, etc.?
Yes.
How will you manage your money? What if they tell you, I'll pay you only 10,000 rupees?
You have to adjust.
How do you adjust? See, assuming you're going for a trip next week, how will you adjust? 10,000, your dad will give to you. What about the rest, 5,500? You may ask your friends, you may borrow, take a loan. This is how economy works also, right? Now when they say budget, the government will plan all the expenditures. How do they get the money to, you know, spend? They have internal accruals. For example, tax collections, direct tax, indirect tax, from all the collections they have one money. But they may still fall short of the expenditure target. If the expense is 100 rupees, they may collect 80 rupees. What happens to the 20 rupees? This is called as deficit. In budget terms, for your reference, this is called as deficit. It's called fiscal deficit. For your sake, it is called as a shortage. How will they manage the shortage? They may have to borrow. If they borrow, their cost of borrowings will go up. That is interest, they will pay interest. So considering all these factors, a proper exhaustive budget is prepared. Right? Now, for me to start analyzing it right away, as I told you what is a budget. I gave you a brief introduction of fiscal deficit. Can I explain it to you how fiscal deficits impact the economy right away? No. Can I tell you one of the proposals in the budget was to increase the standard deduction from 40,000 to 50,000. Do you know what standard deduction is? No. So what I'll be doing is, more than keeping myself busy only on the union budget, I'll deviate a little, talk about income tax as well. Right? Because to be fair, most of us would be concerned about the tax reforms. Now, if you look at the budget speech, I'm sure no one has seen the budget speech here. When you look at the budget speech, the first part of the budget is basically boasting. The government tells all its achievements, what we have done, how much we have spent, and then how much they want to spend next. They'll say, we are paying 50,000 crores for Ujjwala Yojana, they're paying 20,000 crores for that Yojana. That will not impact you directly. It may impact you people somewhere, but it will not impact us, commerce students, directly. Right? What impacts us is basically the tax reforms. When they say, we'll have to pay tax on this particular figure, there's an exemption, there's a rebate. We'll discuss what is that a little later. That concerns us. So I just spoke to the principal also. What I'll be doing is more than sticking myself to union budget and telling you about unwanted things like how much is made a provision there, how much provision is made here, which will not help us at all. What I'll be doing is to contribute to your further studies also. For example, when you move to degree next, we'll have income tax. Before you even open income tax book, you will be to a good extent thorough income tax. Right? So even if you bump your subjects later, sorry for saying that, you will still pass easily in your exams. So today's session we'll concentrate on union budget, highlights as it what are the important points there, and we'll move on to the tax part. And we'll correlate as to how the budget impacts your income tax. Is that fine?
Yes.
So to begin with, we'll quickly see what is union budget. It's a comprehensive display of government's finances. I discussed with an example. A simple document detailing government's receipts and payments. What are government's receipts? It's tax collections. Government will get dividends from government institutions like RBI and public sector. So they'll get dividends. That is a source of income. How will they spend? They have the source. They have the expenditure plan. The difference is called deficit. For now, keep it as it is. Budget is a report that Government of India's revenue and expenditure for the entire fiscal year. Now, budget is prepared for a fiscal year. What is a fiscal year? there's a difference between calendar year and financial year. So usually budget is prepared for April to March. No, the government won't decide that, okay, today I'll be doing a budget and I'll prepare the budget, present the budget. They'll have something called as pre-budget exercise. Now, in my example which I asked about the trip, going to Goa, did you ask someone? Did you consult your parents?
Yes. In the example.
You should? Yes. In your example, you can't directly go to Goa with friends without asking your parents.
Yes.
No, did you consult your parents? Did you consult your friends? The government will do the same thing here. Right? Before presenting someone, what they do is they'll meet all the experts in the industry. They'll meet economists, they'll meet industrialists, they'll meet manufacturers, they'll meet villagers, they'll meet all people from all sections of the society. They'll take their inputs. Now, to say in layman's term, pre-budget exercise is just analyzing how and what is the health of the industry. Right? Before budget, what they do? They analyze the health of the society, country. Budget is like giving a medicine to improve the health. What the point?
Yes.
I analyze the situation first. Through budget, it's like you are giving a medicine to improve the situation. It's a simple example. So, union budget is preceded by an economic survey which outlines the broad direction of the budget and the economic performance of the country. They tell what is the, through economic survey, we get a detailed report of how the economy is performing, how the country is performing, how each sector is performing. And then economic survey helps us to know the health of the economy, while the budget is the medicine to improve the health and well-being of the economy. We just discussed that. So, what do they do first? They'll meet everyone, they'll take inputs from everyone. What happens next? Presentation. Nowadays it's happening on the 1st of February. Till few years back it was happening on the last day of February. Now they have moved it to 1st day of February. But fine, 1st February is fine. But if the government is running in its 5th year, right? Now if it is say 2016, we are in 2nd or 3rd August of 2016, say. Now this previous government formed from 2014 to 2019. So the government is in continuance, correct? Right? It's in continuity. But the last year when we saw, this year, 2019, the government was officially in power as at February 1st till May. Right? After May, elections would be there and new government may or may not come up. So what happens technically is, 14, the second half, 15, 16, 17, 18, they will present a full budget. But in 2019, when there may be a change in government, they will present something called vote on account. It's not called a full-fledged union budget. Though everything else remains same, the terminology will not be called as union budget. They may call it interim budget because the government would still have to incur some expenditure for the 3 months, right? February, March, April. They'll have to incur, so they'll present the budget, interim budget, and they'll get it passed in the parliament. What happens after the change in government? Now Modi government was there, they continued. Now, last month when they presented the budget, they gave the second half of the budget. But it's not technically the second half, it's like giving a new budget altogether. So what happens in such situations? The example in current year, I'll give you a practical example of practical situation as to how it happens actually. 15, 16, 2007, 2008, it will be a normal budget. But if you see the 2019 budget, February, or 2014 budget, or 2009 budget, when there may be a change in the government, usually what happens is you can expect freebies. What are freebies? Like they give you more and more benefits so that you vote for the same government.
Yes.
Practical, I'm not pro or against the establishment, I'm just giving you practical examples as to how it actually functions. Now 2019, what may happen? February, when they present the interim budget, they'll give you many freebies. Income tax, they might reduce the rate, they might give you something called rebate, we'll see that later. They'll give more and more benefits to poor people, they'll give more and more benefits to where they can get more votes, right? Now they came to power. Now if you see in the previous budget, not many benefits were given. Why? No one will ask them for the next 5 years. You voted them, they are there. Now it's their call. They can do whatever they want. What happens next 2020? A small bit of benefit will be given to you. 2021 a little more. 22 more than 21. 23, 19, 24. When 24 budget comes, you can expect more and more freebies again. Practically, this is how it happens. Even when the Congress government was there for 10 years, the last government, or even before that, practical situation is this. But that doesn't stop us from understanding what would be there in the budget. Now what happens in 2004, 2009, 2014, 2019, you will have two budgets. So for today's session per se, we'll be covering both the highlights of the February budget as well as this. Because what happens now, who is the finance minister? You know that, right? Who presented in February? Piyush Goyal. The finance minister was Arun Jaitley, but because he was sick, he was the caretaker finance minister. So he proposed the budget in February. When Nirmala Sitharaman presented the budget this time, in most of the places she gave a reference to the February budget. Saying that we have already announced this. What does it say? We are not announcing anything new. So for all practical purposes, we can add both February as well as the previous budget and then call it the budget for this year. For all practical purposes. Right? So budget is presented on the 1st of Feb. So why is it important? Usually I'm not a fan of looking at the slides and explaining. I give more and more practical examples so that you can easily relate. But still, we have some bit of theory here. Budget subject sheets, one of us. Budget determines how the finance minister spends and invests money and how the same affects the fiscal deficit. Now, if he invests or if he spends more, will the fiscal deficit go up or go down? What is deficit? Shortage. So if he spends more, shortage will go up?
Yes, sir.
If he spends less, shortage will go down. So all the industrialist economists will keep a close track as to how much is being spent. In the previous economic presentation I was giving on budget, in February, after the first budget was presented, it was only economic students. So they had more knowledge about it. As soon as I told something, they used to ask me doubts immediately. What they asked here was, it's a valid question. Now if you know about this, I don't know if you know, government had told people who have less than 1 hectare of land will be given 2000 in installments, etc., etc. Now if you calculate that, it will come up to a big, very big amount of money. Along with that, there was something called, if I'm not wrong, if you remember correctly, Ayushman scheme, I don't remember the name correctly, but around a lakh crore of rupee was set up there, but it was still not paid. So if they pay it now, the deficit will again go up. So the government had told that 3.6 will be the target, 3.7 will be the target, but most of us in that room decided that that was a hyped figure. As in, cannot be met. Because if the government says the fiscal deficit has gone to 4% from the current 3.5%, it's a half percentage increase, which is a very big figure in terms of money. So the stock market would fall down, economics would say, no, the government is not spending properly, they're not utilizing the money properly. All these problems would arise. So the conclusion there in that room, I was in the panel with the HOD of BU, Bangalore University itself, and one socialist also from Law College, JNU. All of us agreed that that was not a valid figure. Fine, that was one part. So this budget always affects the fiscal deficit. How well you spend, fiscal deficits will change accordingly. The fiscal measures undertaken by the government affects public expenditure. Now fine, there will be fiscal deficit because our tax collection and money to the government will always be less than the expenditure. How will they manage this fiscal deficit? That is the point of observation in all the budget. So this is one. An increase in indirect taxes decreases the demand. Now what is indirect tax? There are two types of taxes. One is direct tax, one is indirect tax. Do you know the difference? Can someone quickly say? Tell what's the difference?
Based on products.
On products is what?
Tax included.
What is direct? What is indirect?
We have to pay income tax and direct tax.
Okay. You can just sit down. Indirect tax?
We have the same products, including tax, indirect.
You are right. So what happens is, now say today I am here, tomorrow I am going to a company, after tomorrow I am going to one more institution. Now they may pay me some professional fees. Right? Assume it comes up to 10 lakh per annum. My professional fees from various sources, example, may come up to 10 lakh per annum. Now on this 10 lakh, I will have to pay tax according to the income tax labs. This is my direct tax. My income tax is paid, this is direct tax to the government. Now, for the sake of the presentation today, I bought a new laptop. Right? The laptop costs 50,000 plus say 18% GST. Say for our simplicity sake, I'll say 60,000 total including GST. Now, this GST isn't a tax. Goods and services tax. So did I pay directly to the government?
No, sir.
Whom did I pay to? I paid it to the shopkeeper. He paid it to the government. So indirectly, who's getting the money?
Government.
So this is called indirect tax. Direct tax is what we pay to the government and the income earned by us. Indirect tax is on all the products and services which we avail. We won't pay tax directly, we'll pay tax indirectly to the government. At the end of the day, government gets the money. How can you justify this point? An increase in indirect taxes decreases the demand. Now say, this laptop costs 50,000 plus tax, 10,000 tax, round figure, example. What if the tax rate changed from 18% to 28%, resulting in the tax amount from 10,000 to 20,000? So the laptop example, okay, don't calculate. This will cost 50 plus 20 now. Will I buy this laptop directly? Because it's an increase of 10%. So when the indirect tax goes up, the value, the demand for the product may go down. I may not buy it. Right? So if the government increases the indirect tax, what may happen? The demand may go down. If the demand goes down, what will happen? The supply will remain as it is. So supply will be more, demand will be less. The price of the product may go down again. It's like a full circle. So this is one point to note. And also increases the direct taxes decreases the disposable income. What is disposable income? Which you can spend. Thus reducing the demand for the goods. Now, both points are similar. Going back to my professional fees example, say 10 lakhs per annum. There are various labs from 2.5 to 5, 5 to 10, more than 10 lakhs I mean. There are percentage assigned for various labs. Now say, in the earlier regime, I was paying a tax of say 2 lakh rupees on 10 lakhs. I got 10 lakhs, I'll be paying a tax of 2 lakh rupees on that. But if they increase the direct tax rate, 2 lakhs may become 3 lakhs. So from my hand, did 1 lakh extra go? So my disposable income went down. My buying power will go down again. So again, it's linked to the economy. Though it impacts us individually, for us collectively, it will impact the economy. Because like me, even you will not buy this laptop at the price. You may not have the money to buy the laptop. So what will happen? Overall demand may also go down. So that is why each and every point of the budget is taken care of. And as I also discussed, as a commerce professional, as commerce students, we will mostly be looking at something called Part B, which is the tax reforms. But there will be industrialists, economists, people in the manufacturing other sectors, they will be looking at appropriation part. That is, how is the government giving money to us? Right? So, for the tax sake, we'll be interested. For the other appropriation sake, the industrialists and economics would be involved. They'll be more interested than us in that part. Because that affects them directly. Tax affects us directly. Even though tax affects them, but it affects us more because that may be our only source of income. For them, they'll consider the macro part. For us, we'll look at our only individual calculations. So, fiscal deficit, we already discussed, you know what that is, right? What is fiscal deficit? It's a difference in borrowing over lending. I'm borrowing and I'm lending. Lending is basically expenditure. Borrowing is either my money which I get or I'll borrow to meet the expenditure. This difference is called as fiscal deficit. The extent of the deficit and the means of financing it influence the money supply and the interest rate in the economy. Already told you, you have to borrow. I'll have to pay interest on that. So how will I manage my fiscal deficit, from where will I borrow, how will I borrow, that will impact the interest rate and money supply. High interest rate means higher cost of capital for the industry, lower profits and lower stock price and vice versa. Obviously, if the cost is high, then cost of capital to the industries will also be high. If it's low, that will be low. So, quickly moving on. Now we know what is budget. Now how is budget presented? As I told you, they won't decide on February 1st and simply come and talk about the budget. First part is government ministries and departments send their budget proposal and requirements. Now, under the government, there are various ministries and departments. Each department will send their own requirement to the finance minister. For example, Department of Mines will say, I want this. Department of something else will say, I want this much. The finance minister will sit and compile all this and consider all their parts. Doesn't mean he'll grant whatever they ask. He'll check with the industrialist, he'll, from the economic survey we already discussed, he'll check the health of the industry and then he'll apportion as per their requirement and his availability also. If they simply ask 1 lakh crore, first of all, you should have 1 lakh crore to give it to him, right? So he'll plan his finances properly, he'll look at how much can be paid, he'll look at how much is available with him and then he'll calculate the payment part. The draft is to be approved by the finance minister in consultation with the prime minister. Now, prime minister is the main person in India, at least in India. So what happens, finance minister will compile, he'll finalize some part of it. He'll consult the prime minister, he'll, for the sake of formality, he'll say yes. Sign on it, he'll come back to the finance minister. He'll then present the budget. What happens next? The final budget is presented in the parliament. Now, what are the contents of the final budget? As I already told you, first part talks about where I am spending the money and how I am getting the money and all the boasting part about the last 3 years, 4 years. The second part talks about the tax reforms, which most of us are interested in. Tax reforms talks about any changes in the tax structure, any changes in the customs and other direct and indirect taxes. Right? So, once the final budget is presented in the parliament, a discussion will be held. Now, if I want to quote the exact terms, the finance minister will say, I now commend the budget to the parliament, house of the, whatever, house. Then the discussion on the final budget starts. If you have any reservations, you can raise it on the spot. Because as a finance minister, I'll be presenting the budget to you guys. What if you see a problem, or what if you want to make it better? Right? You can stand up and you can talk, discuss with the, there's a procedure, but you can discuss with the finance minister. Once everyone speaks, the finance minister will give reply to everyone, and then two bills will be passed. Right? Now all the grants, saying that I'm spending so much here, I'm proposing to distribute so much funds to this department. Once this is done, all the discussion part is done, once it's approved, then the finance minister will, once the grants are approved, two bills are introduced in the Lok Sabha. What are those? One is appropriation bill and finance bill. Appropriation bill covers how much I am spending, how much I am collecting and all the first part of it. Finance bill talks mostly about the tax and other finance related aspects. The revision of tax proposals are also discussed and voted. Now if there is any change in tax structure, again the same discussion will be held on that and voted. Once the voting is done, budget is set to be approved. This is the process of budget. Now, as your principal told sometime back, most of us will be keenly watching the budget because the entire economy will be impacted, stock markets will be impacted, right? So what would happen if there is a leak in the data? For example, if the finance minister is planning, saying that 2.5 lakh is the exemption limit, income tax exemption limit, you have to pay tax bill 2.5 lakhs. I am proposing to make it to 5 lakhs. If he has thought about it, and if he has made a note, and he has given it for printing. What if the printer takes a duplicate copy, sells it for money outside? May happen. Right? So if such leaks can cause a tremendous impact on the economy also. So how it happens is, say 1 week before the budget, in the North Block where the finance ministry is situated, all the finance officials who are part of the budget are completely locked away from the outside world. They won't be having any contact with the outsiders. So they'll be having their own place and they'll be planning and presenting the budget right there. And PIB, Press Information Bureau, which has a tie-up with the government to release all the information, they have a printing machine in the basement itself. So the budget is also printed in the basement. And PIB will be invited for 2-3 days to just present the budget in 3 languages, English, Hindi and Urdu. So the budget notes will be converted in 3 languages. So PIB will be called there again. The people who come there will also have no contact with outsiders. Once the budget day comes, have you seen the finance minister carry the suitcase?
It will be taken
to the parliament, and sometime, half an hour, whatever, before the actual budget presentation, the government may or may not discuss it with their own ministers first. They say no, but it will happen that the basic or the main parts will be discussed with the ministers and the ruling parties people first, because they'll have to clap. No. What if the finance minister is proposing something very important and you don't understand it? People will think it's not good. I'll give you an example. In February when the budget was presented, observation, you should have very good observation. I was watching it live as in on TV. Piyush Goyal started by saying, there is no change in the tax structure for this year. What does that mean? There are slabs and there are some percentages, and he said, first sentence in part B, tax reform, what he said was, there are no changes in the tax structures, there is no change at all. Right? Then he moved on by saying, up to 5 lakh you won't be paying any, I'll be giving a rebate of, if you have the taxable income, up to rupees 5 lakhs. Now in the income tax, if your income is 0 to 2 lakh 50, you don't have to pay any tax. If your income is 2 lakh 50,000 to 5 lakhs, you'll have to pay 5%. 5 lakh to 10 lakh, 20%, more than 10 lakh, 30%. That's the income tax structure. Now what did he mean when he said there is no change in the tax structure? This remains same? 5%, 20%, 30% remains same? And then he said, I propose to give a rebate if your income is up to rupees 5 lakhs. Everyone started clapping. After the budget, all the TV analysts, panelists, the TV anchors, experts, economists, even few chartered accountants, everyone said, up to 5 lakh, you don't have to pay any tax. This is a very good budget. After a week, I went to the income tax department for a training for the income tax officers. I met the director there. I asked her, how did you find this budget? What about the 5 lakh part, which the finance minister announced? Even she told, even people in the income tax department did not understand what that means. Because for a layman, when I tell you, you don't have to pay tax up to rupees 5 lakhs, what do you mean? Even if your income is 10 lakhs, up to 5 lakhs, no tax. That is what it means. But everyone was wrong. Because they didn't pay attention to the first line properly. What did it say? No change in the tax structure. What is rebate? Not many people knew. So they confused rebate with flat exemption. I'll tell you what rebate and exemption is a little later. So this is why, what if this was announced already? People would plan accordingly. They look at, you know, how people in stock markets are. People like you and me may also, I am also invested in stock market, regular investor in stock market, so I know how it works. If the government is presenting something today, I'll analyze. For example, if the government say, I'm allocating 60,000 crores for irrigation projects. You know what I'll do first? If I'm regular into stock markets, I'll quickly check the list. I look at the item, list of stocks who are in the irrigation sector. Let's say Jain Irrigation, one of the companies, I'll buy it. Because if the government is motivating that sector to grow, then tomorrow that sector will grow up. It will go up. So I'm investing it right now when the price is less. So I'm doing it after the announcement. But just imagine what would happen if it's leaked and if it's announced before the budget announcement is officially done. What if there is some small leaks? They can manipulate the stock markets like anything. Me and you will usually react to post the transaction is done. But there will be many hawkeyes. Forget what's happening in reality. The news will go to them first. There are people like that. I've seen few people like that and they'll make very good money. That's like a very good career for them. So to control all these, there'll be a proper isolated place in the North Block. They won't be having any contact with outsiders. Even the printing happens in the same basement. PAB newspaper will be called and they'll be asked to, you know, make 3 versions of it. Only when the budget is officially being presented, that is when the news will go out. That is the first time the announcements are being made to the public. As I told you, why is it done in isolation? Any leak in any news will impact the economy as well as the stock markets. So to control this, this is the procedure. This is actual procedure as to how it is done. So this is how a budget is prepared. What is a budget, first of all? How a budget is prepared? What is fiscal deficit? And etc. Now, it's 2:30 now. For the next 1 hour, I can go on and tell you the boasting made by the government. Appropriations made by the government. Government has given 60,000 crore to one sector. Will it help you? So what we will do is, let us not discuss all the provisions. Right? So we'll be looking at only the important items which will impact you and me. Right? So along with this, what we'll be doing is, as I discussed, we'll be looking at some part of income tax also. Because as I told you, standard deduction 40,000 to 50,000. You should know what standard deduction is, right? Now, again, as commerce students, you will definitely be looking at income tax, you'll be paying income tax in the future. We look at what are the heads of income, how is it classified as per income tax, what is something called as TDS, right? How will you pay tax, what are the rates, and how will this budget announced in 2019, both the budgets, impact our calculations, right? Will you move on?
Yes.
So, if you look at it here, this is officially released by PIB, Press Information Bureau. Can you see that? I'll increase the font size. So once the budget is done, this work is done by so they will give you something called as highlights of the interim budget. Now the budget speech will go on for us together, 2 to 3 hours sometimes even more. But not all will be important to all of us. So they'll issue something called as highlights. So what is covered in this, I'll quickly look at few important announcements. They say, see, 12 crore small and marginal farmers to be provided with assured yearly income of 6,000 per annum under PM Kisan. This is the 2,000 part I told you about. So if they say 12 crore farmers will be impacted, and it also said there are few conditions there. Is it given in this? No. So 1 hectare, less than 1 hectare, etc., less than 5 hectares, etc. If this is the condition, we found so many loopholes in those conditions. Like what if only you are the owner? For example, you own 1 hectare. I come and work for you in that 1 hectare. Will you get the money or will I get the money? Because the government says who owns less than one hectare. First of all, should he owning the land? Should he be owning the land? And will the worker get the money? So indirectly, if you see, the money may go to the owner itself, not the tenant. So we discussed so many cases like this, but anyways, outlay of 75,000 crore for FY 2019-20 and additional 20,000 crore in financial year 2018-19. Why this additional thing came up was, they decided to give it from previous year, retrospectively. Budget was prepared in February, presented in Feb, but they told we'll start the installments from December itself. So the problem here was, the budget for that particular was already presented in the last year. That is why they had to change and make an extra provision of 20,000 crore so that the retrospective effect, the impact would be given December, Jan, Feb and March. Now when this happens, last year's fiscal would also change, fiscal deficit will also change because there is extra spending here. Right? So last year's fiscal deficit will also go marginally, but the government probably didn't talk about this at all. And outlay for Rashtriya Gokul Mission increased to Rs. 750. There are so many things like this. This happens before the, I mean after the posting part, they'll tell where and what will be done. For example, if you see something like 2% interest subvention to farmers for animal husbandry and fisheries activities, additional 3% in case of timely repayment. I told you all the provisions will impact one or the other person, but not us as commerce students and commerce people directly. Right? So all there are few provisions which is given here, something pertaining to labor, 3,000 per month after 60 years of age with an affordable contribution of only 155 per month. This is like your insurance scheme. You know how it works? They say if your age is up to 29 or something, you will pay 55 rupees per month. At the end, you will get 3,000 per month after 60 years every year. So some insurance related scheme was also announced. 22 AIMS to be set up in Haryana, 60,000 crore allocation for Manrega. So all these are there, but we won't be discussing it at depth. This was announced. Direct tax proposals. What is the first line you see? This is from PIB itself. Right? Now when they say income up to rupees 5 lakhs exempted from income tax, is this correct? It is wrong. Why? Because there is a difference between exemption and rebate. If people like them confuse you, who are commerce students itself, what will a layman do? That's why I told you, even the government officials, TV anchors, experts in TV, everyone got it wrong. Because they didn't pay attention to the first line. It said no change in tax structure. How can there be no change in tax structure? Also, exemption would be increased. It cannot happen. I'll practically discuss as to what will be the impact of this and the treatment of this, we'll discuss a little later. More than 23,000 crore tax relief to 3 crore middle class taxpayers. The impact of that. Standard deduction to be raised from 50,000 to 40,000. Do you know what standard deduction is? No. We'll discuss that when we discuss some part of income tax. That's why I told you, we can't directly discuss everything in the sheet because you are still young. You are still in your POC. You will not have encountered this yet. We'll definitely check this out in your degree. But for POC, because you are here, I can't explain everything right now. But whatever are the major proposals, I will discuss with respect to tax also, how it's impacted. TDS threshold to be raised from 10,000 to 40,000 on interest earned on bank post office deposits. So we'll quickly see what is TDS, because it is coming in this direct tax proposal. It will impact all of you tomorrow again. Now, I have an academy. See, I have an academy and there is one assignment. One company called me to give a lecture on, say, budget itself, right? They proposed to pay me 50,000 for a full day session. 50,000 will be my income, correct? It's my professional fees which I charge them. Will they pay me entire 50,000? First question. Second, if I am GST registered, if I have a GST registration, I'll have to add GST and then charge it to them, right? 50,000 plus 18% GST, and then I'll pay it to the, I'll give a bill accordingly. They'll make the payment, but will they make the full payment again? For the sake of this example, I'm not registered into GST. I'll charge only 50,000 to them. How much will they pay to me? Will they pay the entire 50,000 to me?
No.
They will do something called as TDS. This is called as? What is the full form anyone knows?
Tax
deducted at source. So what's happening is, you can link it like your indirect tax itself. How it functions in indirect tax? It functions similarly. For example, you have to pay me 50,000 rupees. Will you pay me the entire 50,000 rupees? No. You will deduct a tax of 10%. That's why it's called tax deduction at source, tax deducted at source. You yourself are deducting tax and giving the balance amount to me. So this money which I get is already tax pay, logically speaking, correct? Now, there are various rates. There are rates for salaries, commissions, and the rent on movable and immovable properties, commission, professional charges, royalty. There are rates to all different classifications. This attracts 10%. Professional charges comes under 184J. This aren't classified under 10% stuff. Now, how much will you deduct now? 10% of 50,000 rupees. So, how much is it? 5,000 rupees. You transfer balance 45,000 rupees to me. What happens to the 5,000 then? You deducted it. It's with you. You will pay to the government. You will deposit that money with the government, quoting my PAN number. So when you deposit the money, when you file your TDS returns, make the challan, file the TDS returns, quoting my PAN, in my income tax portal, when I file my returns, I'll calculate my tax. Assume I have made 10 seminars like this, of 50,000 each, assume. 50,000 into 10 will be? 5 lakhs. 5 lakhs will be my total income. I'll calculate tax accordingly. I'll deduct all the taxes paid by me already. Now, if there is say 5 lakh or 10 lakh, there will be different rates. 5%, 20%, 30% as we discussed, right? But here, tax is deducted only at 10%. So there may be a difference between the tax payable there and here, tax paid by me already. So assume my income is around 5 lakhs. Assume, it won't be this much, but assume the tax payable is 50,000 rupees. Assume. 50,000 total income, tax payable on my income is 50,000 rupees. People like you have deducted tax on the money paid to me worth 40,000 rupees. Right? So what will I do? Tax payable 50,000 minus tax already paid by me. TDS 40,000. Balance 10,000 you will have to pay tax to the government when you file the returns. What if my tax calculation comes out to 50,000 rupees, but the tax deducted is 60,000 rupees? What happens then? The tax paid by me directly is more, but the tax payable logically is only 50. What happens in this case? You will get the money back from the government. The term is called refund. Right? So the 10,000, you will get it back from the government. In most of the cases, as soon as your return is verified, approved by the government, in some cases you will get it 15 days, in some cases you will get after 2-3 years also. I have personally gone to income tax department asking for refunds from the AY-1617 also, but still I have not got it. My clients, but anyways. So that is the concept of TDS. Now what was happening was, on interest, right? Now say for example, your parents or your grandparents will be 50-60 plus. They would have some fixed deposit in their banks. That will fetch them some interest, right? Now income is taxable. What will happen if the income, there's a limit of 10,000 rupees. If the interest was more than 10,000, TDS would be attracted. Even though that was the only income, right? TDS would still be attracted. unless you give a certificate, we will not discuss about that. An exemption certificate given. But for the sake of practical example, TDS will be done on this particular amount. Say 11,000 interest, TDS will be done on that. Even though they may not have to pay tax at all, because as per their income tax calculation, they will not fall under the taxable limit itself. TDS would still be deducted. Now the problem comes here when you will have to file your return and take the money back. Many people have come to me asking for this particular help in filing returns because, say example, I come here today. This is my only lecture in this particular year, right? 1920 financial year. This is my one and only lecture. Say for the sake of example, they'll pay me 50,000 rupees. Say 10% will be the tax deducted. How much is it? 5,000 rupees. I have to file my return now. I will go to my CA or a tax consultant. He'll ask for 7,000 rupees as my income tax return filing fee. What will happen if I file my return? I'll have to pay 7,000 to him. How much benefit will I get because of filing this return? 5,000. So net, I'm actually paying 2,000 more to him for filing this return. Right? On the other hand, what if the refund I'm supposed to get was 5,000 rupees? He's asking only for 3,000 rupees. Now can I go to him? Net, there is still a loss to me, right? There were a lot of problems which were happening for small taxpayers. That is why this limit of 10,000 is increased from 10,000 to 40,000 rupees now. So till it crosses 40,000, no TDS will be done. You know what TDS is now, right? In this case, the bank will deduct tax, they'll pay, you can get the benefit later if you have tax payable. If you don't have tax payable, you will get the money back which is already deducted as tax. So this was one of the changes proposed. Now again they say existing rates of income tax to continue, and they say exemption up to 5 lakh. They are contradicting their own points here. This is PAB, not some local or private channel. So we will come to this particular part later. I will explain with example. They say tax exempted on notional rent on second self-occupied house. Here I won't be discussing in depth, but out of the 5 slabs of income, 5 heads of income in income tax, we have something called salary. Income from salary first, income from house property, income from business and profession, capital gains, and income from other sources, whatever is not covered under this code. So this comes under the second head of income, income from house property. I mean, I won't, you know, transfer too much to your head so that you'll get confused, but there are something called as self-occupied property, let-out property, etc., and house property. So I won't be discussing that in depth because it will take some time. On notional, on if there is a, say, empty house, for example, or if you have not paid rent, or if the client has, customer has not paid rent to you, in many other circumstances, you will have to calculate something called notional rent and pay tax on it, even though there is no rent received from us. So, on the second house, second self-occupied property, this particular thing was abolished. Housing and real estate sector to get boost. Same thing with rent, right? Now, the rent limit was 15,000 per month. If you are paying rent of less than 15,000 per month, TDS would not be applicable. 15,000 per month comes up to 1,80,000 per annum. So per annum basis, if your rent crosses does not cross 1,80,000, you won't have to do any TDS as tenant. Once it crosses 20,000 rupees earlier, if it had crossed 20,000, you would have to deduct tax and pay the balance to the landlord. You pay the tax to the government on behalf of the landlord. This is also increased from 1,80,000 per annum to 2,40,000 per annum, which is basically 20,000 per month. This is one benefit which rent payers will get. Benefit of rollover of capital gains increased from investment in one residential house to two residential houses for capital gains up to rupees 2 crore. Now the fourth head of income which I told, capital gains. What is capital gain? The gain profit you make on sale of capital goods, shares, whatever it is. There is a provision income tax, again I won't explain in depth because it will be out of your syllabus. There is a provision income tax that if you have a good capital gain, if you buy one property, again time limit, 3 months before or 6 months after, if you buy one house property within that particular period, you will get the exemption. You won't have to pay capital gains on that particular part, only if you fulfill this transaction. The earlier regime said one house, now they have moved it to two residential houses, right? So why this thing was done, logically speaking, why this thing was done was, say you purchased a house in 1980, 1981, 1990s. You purchased it for some 5 lakh rupees or say 1 lakh rupees. You sold it in 2018 or 2019. You got 1 crore rupees. Valuation would have gone up, you got 1 crore rupees. Now, how will you calculate profit? Sale price minus purchase price. So 1 crore minus 5 lakh or 1 lakh. There is something called as indexation, wherein they convert this 1 lakh to current price. So 1 lakh, they use something called CIA, cost inflation index. They'll convert the 1 lakh to current price, so the price may come up to 40 lakhs, say example, right? Now you'll compute 1 crore selling price minus 40 lakh indexed cost price, it is called now. Difference of 60 lakhs is your capital gain. You should pay tax on capital gain separately. But instead of paying the entire tax to the government, if you invest in one house, you would have got this benefit. The problem there was, you have 60 lakhs, you got 60 lakhs as say capital gain, you got 1 crore as money. You buy two houses, right? Nowadays, I mean earlier, even I used to say in a joint family, my grandfather and then my brother, sorry, my dad's brother, and entire family was staying together. Now the concept of joint family is moving away and we are moving into nuclear family, right? How many of you here are staying in joint families? One. Only one out of, okay, two, three maybe, out of 100, 150. This is the situation now. So what's happening is, instead of buying one house, the taxpayer now buys two houses, one for his parents, one for himself. But the benefit earlier was to go to only one house. On the purchase price, whatever is paid by him, on one house he used to get benefit. Now, in such situations also, these two houses will also get the benefit because one residential house has changed to two residential houses now. So that capital gain, the benefit you are getting if you have two houses now. So, I mean, there is a lot to explain there, but considering your field now, still in second PUC, I am not going in depth, but probably when we meet again sometime in your UG class, I will explain in depth later. So, tax benefit, affordable housing, okay, we will not discuss that. Tax exemption, notional rent, it's already there, okay. So this was about the direct tax proposal and they had all this fiscal program. Fiscal deficit pegged at 3.4 of GDP for 2019-20. This was the target set by the government. 3.4% is the deficit shortage. They're saying target of 3% of fiscal deficit to be achieved by 2021. What does this mean? The shortage deficit from 3.4%, we are planning to get it down to 3% by 2021. So what should the government do to reduce this? Either get more money or spend less. So that should be done. Fiscal deficit brought down to 3.4 in 2018-19 from almost 6% 7 years ago. Again, this will be a little boasting part, but okay, they are saying from 6% it has gone down to 3.4%. Total expenditure has increased, total capital expenditure. So let us not go with these figures. It's just there. Poor and backward classes, first right on the resources in country is to the poor. So all these statements will be made. So we can't discuss all the statements. So earlier we were presenting two budgets. One is the normal year budget and one railways budget. I think from, if I'm not wrong, 3 years, almost 3 years back, they have merged both and railways and union budget will be prepared at once, presented at once. And again, if you have seen the photo of Prime Minister Modi meeting all the film actors and heroes, have you seen any photo of that?
Yes, sir.
People would have seen, right? He has taken a selfie. I think, who took the selfie? But selfie was taken with the Prime Minister and the actors and directors of Bollywood. Not the film promotion. But this was the case where all the people in the entertainment industry, filmmakers, actors, met the Prime Minister and gave their proposals to the Prime Minister. As I told you, through economic survey and otherwise also, the government will meet all possible sections of the society and take inputs from them. Similarly, those people met Prime Minister Modi and gave a set of proposals. So if you look at it, Indian filmmakers to get access to single window clearance as well for case of shooting films, regulatory provisions to rely more on self-declaration, to introduce anti-camcording provisions in the Cinematography Act. So they probably gave a few suggestions. The government considered few suggestions, they have put it in their budget. Similarly, if you look at MSME and traders, they would have met representatives from this particular sector, they would take inputs from them, put it in the budget. Put it in the budget only what is rational and logical and how much they can afford, the government can afford. So there are many other situations, there's some 13-page document. None of it impacts us directly because I've gone through this entire document. None of it impacts us directly, though one or two points may be impacted. So this was the highlights of that particular budget. Now if you look at the second part of the budget, this was the budget presented in February. Now when this budget was presented, this recent budget was presented by Nirmala Sitharaman, most of the cases she gave reference to the February budget itself, like we have done in February, that continues, right? Along with that, she came up with few new provisions. One of them is, for you to file income tax return, PAN card is compulsory, PAN number is compulsory. Now she has introduced that PAN and Aadhaar can be substituted. If you have Aadhaar card, you can still file your income tax return. One of the good proposals proposed. And coming from the CA background itself, I have seen it practically. The torture faced by the taxpayers when it comes to the income tax. You would have seen Siddhartha's case, right? Coffee day owner. He has told, I was subject to severe harassment by the income tax officials. It may be true, may not be true. But if the income tax comes to your place, no matter how good you are, no matter how correct you are, you will get scared. Because it's income tax department, that's what, you know, the notion is there among the people. So what used to happen was, I have a company, right? Company is going on well. I get an assessment from the income tax department. Assessment is where the income tax wishes to scrutinize our accounts and they'll ask for more and more details from our end. We'll file a return from our end. They might ask for additional information. Now when we go and give the information to them, they'll say, no, I won't consider this. They may reject it. They may point out few mistakes. And whatever benefits we have claimed, they'll say, no, we won't grant it to you, pay more tax on that. Right? And if you don't agree, for example, if they say, after considering, after revising all these parts, you will have to pay tax of rupees 5 crores. Officially. Right? After doing all the calculations, writing back and provisions, etc., writing off, making provisions, claiming benefits, they'll tell you, you will have to pay tax of 5 crores additionally. This is my order. He'll keep the order ready. He'll sign it. He won't give it to you. This happens practically, right? He won't give it to you. It will be on his desk. You should simply take it from him, but he won't give it to you. You know what he'll tell you? Directly on your face, 8 koti officially. You pay me 2 crores, I'll tear it and put it in the dustbin. So if you pay officially, how much will go out from your bank?
5 crores.
Now if you don't pay him, if you pay to the officer itself, how much will go?
2 crores.
So you are indirectly saving 3 crores?
Yes.
How you will account in your books, that is secondary, but you are saving 3 crores. This happens a lot. I told you I am going to the income tax department for getting a refund. From what I have learned, till we pay some money to the inspectors, ask them to move the file will stay as it is. All these are practical, I have told this in the income tax department, they know about this, I have told them I have seen this happen. They know about this, but they can't do anything about it. Unless you go with hidden camera or whatever. Because of this situation, the government came up with one particular thing called e-assessments. E-assessments. E is electronic. Right? E-assessments. It was announced by Piyush Goyal, but more clarity was given by Nirmala Sitharaman. He told by the next 2 years it will be done. When Nirmala Sitharaman told, she gave more explanation to that. Now how it works is, if my company has an assessment, you are the income tax officer of this jurisdiction where the company is situated. So whatever falls in the office's jurisdiction, he has the right over those companies. He can ask for more details, etc. From now what happens is, if there is an assessment, if my company's case is selected for assessment, it happens randomly online, I won't get to know who is the officer involved. The officer will not get to meet me directly. I won't have to go to a physical place with all the hard copies from now. It's not implemented, but it will be implemented soon. What happens is, this communication will go to a central cell. It's like a mediator, right? Now if the system has picked my case as assessment case, randomly this will be deputed to one officer. name will not be given to me. If I have to reply with the documents, I won't reply to the officer's mail. I won't be sending the information to the assessing officer. Instead, I'll be sending the information to the central cell. From there, he'll get it. He won't get to know more detail. But this is how it is planned. How successful it will be, we'll have to wait and watch. But why this is done? To curb illegal corruption, illegal transactions, corruption. This was one good measure which was announced. Notably, these were the two which I personally liked. There were few many others like I mean, she said this is a 35D investment fine, angel tax. Startups are subject to something called angel tax. We'll discuss that a little later. Again, startups got a lot of benefits this time and some more benefits, but nothing significant as such. And also, there was one provision that 2% on cash withdrawals. If the withdrawal is more than 1 crore in a year from a bank account. If you have a bank account, if you withdraw more than 1 crore, 2% will be deducted as tax, TDS again. This was announced by Nirmala Sitharaman this year. Notably, these were the things. I put everything in my PPT, but as I was telling the principal, last night when I stayed back and did it, the system crashed, the operating system crashed. The PPT is still there in the system, but I'm not able to access it because the OS is corrupt. So in the morning, whatever you saw in the PPT, I had to type it and then I had to come here. That's why I'm referring to the PDF. But what I did is I copied the same from PDF to my PPT. But anyways, I'm directly referring to the PDF now because I don't have time to prepare the entire PPT. So if you look at it, vision for 5 trillion economy, new Jal Shakti to be, and transport of rural lives, most of it will be generic statements, right? I won't be talking about generic statements at all because that may or may not concern me. He'll say vision of 5 trillion, but to achieve that, we'll have to work. He didn't tell how we'll work directly. So, I mean, those are all just general points made. Harnessing India's space abilities, enhancing ease of direct and indirect taxation. So, many other provisions were announced. Here again, there's nothing much which is worth explaining, but I'll just give you an example as I told you how income tax works and how the extra benefits which was given earlier and now will be. You'll see if you look at this faceless e-assessment. A scheme of faceless electronic assessment involving no human interface to be launched this year. So that was also announced. So this is again budget highlights. I've taken it from the Union Budget's official site itself. Now moving on, what I'll be doing is budget introduction, the basic spine. Now to talk more about the budget and to analyze how it will impact the tax provisions, we'll do that with the help of one Excel sheet, wherein we'll also discuss a little bit about income tax as well. Right? As I told you, I told the principal also, I'm deviating a little from budget part to income tax part also, so that you will have the knowledge. Now if I can talk more and more about the items in the PDF, electrification, Gramin, Sadak, etc., etc., may not help you, but income tax will definitely help you. So just give you a good heads up. The first thing we do is computation of total income. Right? How will we do this? Is it, can you see this?
Yes, sir.
Should increase the amount? Better. So this is how income tax should be computed. I told you there are 5 heads of income. Whatever income I get, for example, I came here today, if they pay me something, that's my professional fees. I have my company, GST Garage, tax consultant. If that company gets money, I'll pay classified under income from business profession. If I'm a salaried person, it's income from salary. If I get dividend from a company, what's dividend? You know, companies is formed by share capital. Shareholders may or may not get some part of dividend depending on the performance of the company. That dividend will be classified as income from other sources, but dividend is exempt. But still, for the sake of the dividend, interest, all these are income from other sources. I have sold an asset, made a profit, capital gain, tax deductible capital gains. I have a house property, I've given it on rent, I get rent, I treat it as income from house property. So the five major income head are income from salaries. First, we have income from house property. We have income from business slash profession. We have capital gains. We have income from other sources. This is my total income. So when I compute my total income, say what income in salaries, if I am a salaried person and if I am getting salary from my employer, that will come in salaries. I mean salaries, I don't think I can. I had kept form 16 ready with me. So what happens is, all your salary details will be given in some form given by your company, where they'll tell you what is your basic salary, what are your perquisites. What are perquisites? Perquisites which like extra benefits given to you by the company, right? That, how much is that? How much is the allowance given by the company to you? How much is your deductions, etc. officially? All those things will be given in the form of one statement, will be given to you. So here, say income from salary is about 2 lakhs. There was a standard deduction. If you are a salaried person, there is a standard deduction of 40,000 rupees from your salary income. So what happens here? Here when I say deductions, I'll say less 40,000. And then here when I put it outside, I'll say this plus this. 1,60,000 is my net income. 1,60,000 is my income from salary. So this is my official salary which I am getting. Any deductions will come be deducted from the salary itself. This will be my net salary which I'll get. Now here, the 40,000 which is written here, they propose to increase it to 50,000 from the next year. 40,000 was there, it is increased to 50,000 rupees. This is the first change. Comes under salaries, calculate the total first, deduct the standard deduction. You will get the net salary. There are other deductions also, but because there is no change, I am not talking about this. Because this 40,000 was there in the budget speech, I just give an example. You will have to pay something called as the professional tax, you will have to pay other deductions. That will also be deducted from here and the final amount will come, come to your outer column. This is your final income from salary. Next, moving on to host property. What will come in host property? Any rent? We saw something called notional rent. All this comes under house property. So we won't be discussing much because it will take more time. How do you calculate rent, etc., municipal value, that value, this value? There are a lot of things to be discussed. So assuming, say, 1 lakh, I'll simply write it here. Assume this is the amount as per your house property. Next, income from business and profession. Say I have a business or I have a profession. In this is profession what I am doing now. I will get 1 lakh rupees from sources, I will write it here. Say this amount was around 2 lakh rupees per annum. This will come under income from business or profession. Next, there is something called capital gains. Capital gains is purchase, and when you purchase an asset and when you sell it now, the profit you make on that you have to pay tax. Shares, you purchase and sell shares, securities, mutual funds, any asset, if there is a sale, if there is a capital gain, we'll have to show it as capital gain here. I won't be writing any amount here, I'll tell you why later. Income from other sources. Now, you get a commission income from somewhere, third party, not related to your main business. You get interest from banks, interest from FDs. All these will come under income from other sources. Say something like 50,000. So the total income here would be, as per this example, 5 lakh 10,000 rupees. Correct? This is my total income. Now if you look at this particular highlights, the first part said income up to 5 lakh exempted from tax. Can you see this? First point, income up to 5 lakh exempted from tax. Now, practically speaking, if this was the case, this is your income, we will have to
pay tax.
There is something called as deductions also. Right? What are deductions? Now, you have this much income, fine. But if you have used your money to make an investment somewhere, provident fund, life insurance premium, mediclaim, if you have spent on some cases, under various sections, deductions under section, under chapter 6A it is called, all the deductions are mostly called under 80, section number 80, 80, C, D, CCD and all those parts, 80, G, GG. So if you have made an investment somewhere, repayment of housing loan, life insurance premium amount paid, all these will come under deductions. So we'll be looking at the list. That is not, list is not a priority. Understanding the concept is our intention here. So any deductions like this, say section 80C, I have what, 40,000 rupees, and say 80D, this talks about mediclaim, don't bother about the section etc, just look at the amount, 10,000. So here the total comes up to 50,000 rupees. Now my tax, this is called as taxable income. This is my income, gross total income. This is called gross total income. From here, I have few deductions on which tax is not applicable. That is basically what's happening. From the income of 5 lakh 10, I'm getting this benefit. So what's happening indirectly? My tax income amount is going down. So after all these deductions, the amount I get, this is called as taxable income. Now how do we pay tax on this income? Right, we have slabs given here. One is 0 to 2,50,000. If your income is between 0 to 2,50,000, no tax. If your income is 2,50,000 to 5 lakhs, you will have to pay 5%. If your income is 5 lakhs to 10 lakhs, you pay 20%. If your income is greater than 10 lakhs, you pay 30%. This was 10% 2 years back, they reduced it from 10% to 5%. So it was 10, 20, 30, now it's 5, 20, 30. Right? So now if your taxable income is 4 lakh 16 now, how much tax should you pay? 5%? 5% tax on what amount?
4,60,000.
So 4,60,000 into 5%?
No, sir.
No. So here if you see, up to 2,50,000, no tax has to be paid. So when you calculate this, 0 to 2,50,000, amount of tax will be 0. Here I say tax amount, how to calculate.
2,10,000.
Next year, 2,50,000 to 5 lakh, it is 5%. Now what is the amount I have here? 4,60,000. So here what I will be doing is equal to 4,60,000 minus 2,50,000 into what is the rate of tax?
5%.
So I will say into 5%, 10,500. Will I pay tax here? This part? This part? No. So the total tax to be paid is
10,500.
So here I will say tax amount is 10,500. And there is a cess, health and education cess of 4% on the tax amount. So here I will say cess. For our sake, we will ignore cess and something called surcharge. We will just ignore that for now. This is the tax payable. Right? This is the existing situation as of now. If my income is total taxable income is 4,60,000, fine. This is done. Now when the government says income up to 5 lakh exempt from income tax. Is my income, what did they say? Income up to 5 lakh is exempt from tax. Now is it less than 5 lakhs? Should it be exempt from tax?
No.
Why not? Looking at what is given there. What is given there?
Up to
5 lakh exempt from tax. Is it exempt?
Yes, sir.
Hold your answer. This is first part, right? What would happen if this 2 lakh became 3 lakh? Is my income less than 5 lakhs?
No, sir.
So there are two conditions now. What are the conditions?
One is less than 4%.
This is 4 lakh 60, this is 5 lakh 60. Assume this is the case now. If you look at the proposal made by the government, they said
up to
5 lakh, no tax. But what do they actually mean? In fact, when I went to Sindhi College in for the budget analysis also, I spoke to one of my old faculty there, even she got it wrong. The problem is not, it's not our problem. The government itself, look at this PAB, telling this. What will you understand from this? So you can't blame it on the individuals. The framing of the sentence and how it is explained to us is completely wrong. Actually, what is supposed to happen is, there is something called rebate. Rebate under section 87A. So what happens and what is rebate first of all? There's a difference between exemption and rebate. Got it? When they say exemption, you don't have to pay tax at all. This is one exemption given. 2,50,000. Up to 2,50,000, you don't have to pay tax. If your income is less than 2,50,000, you don't have to file your returns at all. No returns to be filed. No paying tax. This is called exemption. But when they calculate something called rebate, that means you calculate the tax payable. It's like giving a discount. In layman's term, it is like giving you a discount. Now, in this case, what would happen? 10,50,000 is a tax amount. There is a provision, if your income is up to 3 lakh, you will get some amount of rebate. So assume the rebate is 2,000 rupees. Right? Now, how much will I pay in it? 10,500 minus 2,800. $8,500 is what I am supposed to pay. How did I get this 2,000 rebate? You calculate the tax first, then deduct rebate. Now I will delete this for now. The government's intention is giving rebate and not giving exemption. Right? On the next column, I will just give you an example of what happens if it crosses also next. The government's intention is, if your income is less than 4,60,000, right? If your income is less than 4,60,000, is it coming under 5 lakhs?
Yes, sir.
Is it coming under 5 lakhs? 4,60,000?
Yes,
sir. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Is 4,60,000 more or 5 lakhs more?
5 lakhs.
Is 4,60,000 within 5 lakhs?
Yes, sir.
Yes? So this is falling under 5 lakhs, less than 5 lakhs. The government's intention is, if 4,60,000, that is, if your income is less than 5 lakhs, you should calculate the tax payable. Entire money will be given back to you as a refund. So how much is the net tax payable? Will I pay tax?
No, sir.
This is what they mean by you don't have to pay tax if your income is less than
5 lakhs.
Are they saying no tax at all?
No, sir.
You calculate the tax, then you get the rebate. Right? What's the difference between exemption and rebate again?
Exemption
is
no
payment of tax at all, no calculation of tax. Rebate means you calculate tax, you get
rebate.
It's like discount.
Discount.
Can you call it discount? It looks like discount itself. It's like discount. You don't have to pay tax. You should disclose this in your return. This is what they mean. Now, the problem comes when this is 5,60,000. Understood the first scenario?
Yes, sir.
I'm not teaching anything complicated. Simple calculation, right? First, I had income from salary, post property, random amounts I added. From IHF income, my total income is 6,10,000. I also told you there is.
Rebate is not applicable here.
We'll see that. We'll discuss. 6 lakh, 10 is my total income, and then there is something called deduction. I didn't explain much, but we'll get some benefit. So 50,000 assuming the benefit, so my taxable income is 5,60,000 now. Right? 5,60,000 is my taxable income. Is this less than 5 lakhs?
No, sir.
So can I say here 0 to 2,50,000 nil, 2,50,000 to 5 lakh? Because they say up to 5 lakh there is exemption, so I'll call it nil. This will be 0. 5 lakh, here I'll say? 5,60,000 minus 5 lakhs into
20%.
12,000. Is it correct?
Yes, sir.
Correct? What did I do here? What did I do? My taxable income is 5,60,000, right? What else did I do next? I calculated my tax. 0 to 12,50,000 is nil. 12,50,000 to 5,00,000 is nil because it is coming under 5 lakhs. Because the government says, what does the government say? Income up to rupees 5 lakh is exempt from tax. So I am saying up to 5 lakh, no tax, nil, 0. 5 lakh to 10 lakh. Differential, I have to pay tax of 20. What is the amount here given? 5,60,000 is my taxable income. So 5,60,000, that is differential, extra 60,000, I'll be paying tax of 20%, which is 12,000. Is this correct? This is wrong. This is wrong. These are income tax slabs, right? What do they mean by there is no change in slab? This should not change. Did I change it here? Yes, that means I am wrong. This is where people got confused. Like, how you got confused now? Because I told you this is correct and then I put it wrong. Similarly, most of them felt the same. They thought this is the situation. Up to 5 lakhs, I will be paying tax. 5 lakh to 10 lakh, I'll be paying on the differential amount directly 20%. This is wrong. The actual provision says only if your income is up to 5 lakh rupees, right? This rebate will be given to you. A rebate, entire tax will be given back to you as rebate if your income is
less than
5 lakh rupees. But if your income crosses 5 lakhs, this provision is not applicable to you at all. So, what about this? You still have to pay this. You still have to pay this because this rebate thing, you are not eligible. Because your income crossed
5 lakhs.
Now, what should be the answer in this case? I'll have to calculate 5% here. What will be the amount here? 2,50,000, that is 5 lakh minus 2,50,000 into 5%. 2,50,000 into 5%, this is difference. So I'll have to pay a tax of 24,500. What was wrong? What is the misinterpretation? This, don't consider this here, your entire tax payable will be 24,500. Rebate applicable to you?
No, sir.
No rebate applicable to you. So you'll have to pay tax of 24,500. Where is the confusion here in this particular part? Right? Now, if you look at this now, once again, the government's release. Income up to rupees 5 lakh exempted from income tax. Is it exempted first of all?
No, sir.
No? Is this correct then? Wrong. It's not exempted from income tax, but you will get the benefit of rebate. Rebate is discount for your understanding. So calculate the tax payable, do rebate minus your final tax payable will be calculated. What if your income crosses 5 lakhs. This rebate provision is not applicable to you. Got it? Now your parents might file an income tax return. August 31st is the due date. Casually ask them if their income by chance is less than 5 lakhs and if more than 5 lakhs, ask them how much tax or how will they do this tax treatment. At least you can educate your parents in this particular aspect. What is the conclusion here in this case? If your income is less than 5 lakhs, calculate the tax, give a rebate, final tax bill, which is basically zero. Because entire benefit of rebate you are getting it against your tax bill. On the other hand, if this crosses 5 lakh 60, this provision of rebate is not applicable to you. You will go back to the old system of calculation itself. Is this correct now? What did you do earlier? Because it was less than 5 lakhs, I wrote nil and then I calculated. Is that correct?
No.
So, what is the conclusion? If your income is less than 5 lakhs, get rebate on the entire tax. Basically, your tax payable is nil. So, the government's line, to some extent it is correct, saying that up to 5 lakh you won't pay any tax. But this covers people whose income is only up to 5 lakhs. But if it's more than 5 lakhs, they didn't tell this to you. It's not for you at all. So you should not calculate the rebate in that case. You will still be bound by the old provisions of the old slab. That is the reason they are saying income tax slab remains same. Is it same? Even for rebate or no rebate, this remains same? In this case, you calculate the tax payable first. Say if this was less than 4 lakh 60, you calculate the tax payable here first, then give a rebate. But tax calculation is happening through this itself. If your income is more than 5 lakh 60, you're directly taking this. No rebate. That is the only difference. Even you go to any, say, employee or any, you know, person who has some good knowledge, they may still make a mistake in this part. They'll definitely make a mistake in this part. This was announced in February, so it will be, and Nirmala Sitharaman also said that this is what we are told. So we are not giving any more benefits to you. Why? Because first year, as I told you, correct? First year, will you get more benefits?
No.
You will get benefits only in 4th and 5th year, because elections are coming. So in this case, what Piyush Goyal announced, the then finance minister, rebate up to 5 lakh. If your income is more than 5 lakh, no rebate. Clear? I'm telling you again and again, you go to any person, they may still commit a mistake. But you should know what this is. Difference between exemption and rebate. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Now, I had this business provision income, right, of 3 lakh rupees. Assume this is my situation, my income tax case. There is, I'll make it 2 lakhs. Same. This is my tax payable as of now. Now, of this 2 lakh professional fees which I received from various trainings and lectures, they would have deducted tax before paying to me, right? TDS, remember? We discussed some time back. So, before you make the payment to me, you will deduct something called TDS, you pay to the government. So, in this case, on this 2 lakh rupees, tax would have been deducted, TDS would have been done of 10%. Right? Provision charges rate is 10%. So here what I should do is calculate the tax payable. In my example, 24,000 is my tax payable. Here I will say less TDS. Here I will say less TDS. What will be the amount? 2 lakh into 10%, 20,000. Now what is my final tax payable? So it will be this minus, so I will have to pay a tax of only 4 lakh, so 4,500.
Fine.
You have a question, sir?
Fine. Tax payable, okay, fine. Can we enter the session?
Yeah. This is almost done.
Yeah.
Last. The only difference here is, I'll just calculate it 1 minute. If this tax amount, instead of 20, if it was 30,000, correct? My tax payable is only 24,500. TDS is 30,000. Have I paid more tax already? Yes. So this I will get refund from the government. So this is how income tax works. So what did we? What is the major takeaway from this? You know there are 5 heads of income. Compute total income. There are a few deductions. You will get taxable income after deductions. On this taxable income, if your income is less than 5 lakhs, you get entire money as rebate. If your income is more than 5 lakh, rebate is not applicable to you. Government saying of income up to 5 lakh being exempted is wrong. So rebate will not be applicable to you. The 2 lakh up to 5 lakh will still apply to you. You still calculate tax, you still pay the tax.
Yes.
Final tax calculation, if there are any prepaid taxes, if someone has deducted tax on your behalf, because you already have paid tax, that will be deducted, balance will be your final tax payable. So we discussed today the basics of budget, how budget is prepared, how is it presented. We discussed few provisions from the PDF file which I had, and the provisions which had direct impact to income tax, we discussed along with the income tax example and calculation. Any questions on what we have discussed so far? Obviously, we learned something new today, right?
Yes.
So when my net tax is zero, am I then also filing income tax of rupees zero?
If you fall under the exemption limit, in this case 2 lakh 50, if your income is less than 2 lakh 50, no need to pay tax.
After rebate?
You should show rebate because in this case, tax is still payable by you. How is the tax calculation done? Through the slabs. Tax calculation is done, then you get a rebate. This is not done in your offline Excel tool. This is done in your income tax return. So you'll have to file your income tax return and then pay. Only if it is exempt, you don't have to pay. You don't have to file your return at all. But if it's not exempt, even if your tax is zero, it's always advisable.
So I get my rebate after filing my income tax.
Directly, in the calculation you get it. But this you should show in your income tax return before filing. So if your income is less than 5 lakhs, you simply say, process of current is your rebate. Sorry, tax minus rebate, next tax payable is nil. That payment is called as nil return. You are not paying any tax on it. But as a small this thing, I will just tell you, it's always advisable to file your income tax return. Why? Because you want to apply for a credit card or you want to go out for some foreign education, they might ask you for your 3 years income tax return. Previous 3 years. Now what may happen is now from last year the rules have changed. You can file your return only till 1 year after the expiry of the assessment year. So you won't have much time. If for example 18-19 you can file return only till 20 March. So after that you can't file your return. Now if they're insisting on the 3 years income tax return, if you don't have it, it will be a problem. One small tip I can give you when you file your income tax return. Now you guys are in college, right? Are you earning any money?
No, sir.
Zero money whatsoever, right? What you can do is, you can simply show some income from that source, income from that, income from this. Show at least 2 lakhs and file the return. Tomorrow, say, now you should not be telling this. Tomorrow you get some extra money in black, right? You buy a car. The officer will come to you and ask where do you get the money from. You can say, I have got income tax return, I have 2 lakhs here. Wait, I'm just telling you some benefits of income. I'm not telling you to do that. Just telling you the benefits of filing income tax return. Because even though you don't have money, you are telling the income tax department, I have money. Tomorrow, if at all they ask you where the money come from, you say, I have already filed your return. You have acknowledged it. So, income tax return filing has a lot of benefits. Make it a point to file your return, even if it's in the return. It may help you anytime in the future. So, this was about budget and the provisions in budget which impact your income tax. Because you didn't know about income tax, I started with income tax and just explained the budget provisions here. Any more questions? I think we can start with the
budget session.
If it's
please. What is there, Mr. Bhatt? You can take some.
Fine. Thank you, sir, for your clear explanation. Even I got to myself, everybody, all those who are in the stage to pay the income tax, they were under confusion. So he tried to clear that. So we also got benefit out of this. And it's a session. Discussion session, we were waiting for this. It may continue 30 minutes.
Yeah.
And I would like to call Mr. Narasimha Swamy, HOD of Economics, to participate in this. And both are here on stage to discuss about budget. budget 2019. It's just like panel discussion. I request them to take over this session, sir.
I spoke for almost 2 hours now.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
So I think it's time we hear our HOD's version on budget. What he feels about the budget first.
Sir, as an economy watcher, my expectation was not in this budget. Because Modi got majority, even majority more than the first term. Being a middle class human being, this budget has cheated us. Because even till this second, I was thinking that there is a tax exemption up to 5 lakhs. There is a tax exemption up to 5 lakhs. But either Piyush Goyal, who introduced the interim budget, or Madam Sitaraman did not make this concept clear. That means they have made us fool. Do you agree?
The budget was presented on 1st February, right? When was the election?
May.
The due date to file income tax return for individual is July 31st. So, when we listen to the speech, what do? Wow, 5 lakh exemption. No tax up to 5 lakh rupees. We'll be happy. You will vote for BJP because they presented the budget. So after the elections, it's time for you to file the return. Only then you will get the shock that they had told something else, the situation is something else. I mean, I told you beginning itself, I'm not pro or against anyone. Situation is that. So they did it on desperation, or they did it by accident, or they did it just by casually doing it, I don't know. But the explanation was not given. As I told, even the income tax, people in the income tax department did not know the provisions. If you had observed, because I was watching it live, as soon as this was announced, in the parliament they don't clap. They thud the benches like this. This is their mode of clapping. As soon as this was announced, for 1 or 2 minutes, everyone, including people in the opposition, started clapping. Why? Because they thought no tax, they'll be beyond the 5 lakh limit, that is secondary. But they thought this is a very good initiative. As I told, even people in the TV channels, everyone got it wrong. But actual reality is something different, as you pointed out. Like last time, I told you some
one small intervention. No, it is not fair on anyone's the day on which budget was presented. I came to know that. The debate was the very next day morning I was talking. Only up to 5 lakhs means they get benefit. Those whose income go beyond 5 lakhs, they are not eligible for these rebates.
The one thing is you are well educated. You know how to crack it.
It was clear.
Not actually. Even now, as I told you, now you go and ask few people, they are still not clear. I mean, the intention here is not to fool people and not to cheat people. The only thing is, it was, I showed you the PIB press release also. What did it say? Exempt up to 5 lakhs. So the way it was communicated was wrong. They would have simply told there is a rebate, instead of word exempted, if they are told rebate will be given to you, there would not be any problem at all. That's why I to explain the difference between exemption and rebate. So, people like us, who are not following, but people who don't follow parliament and don't follow the speeches properly, they won't sit and listen to each and every speech what they give. They listen to their friends or they listen to people in the TV and then they understand that. So, when people in TV also got it wrong, obviously we are also meant to get it wrong. So, it's not government's fault that they did it on purpose, but just that the explanation was not given properly. Continuing with the point made by my fellow panelist, last year when the budget was presented, I told you, right, fifth year, a lot of SOPs, so this was also one of that, and a lot of benefits were announced, standard deduction, rent benefit, TDS, all those benefits were given. We explained, we saw all of it now. But as he rightly pointed out, there are many people who felt disappointed in this budget, which was given by Nirmala Sitharaman. Why? Because as he again pointed out, last time when Piyush Goyal gave the budget, presented the budget, they had majority. But elections were coming, so they had a risk of losing the majority also. But now, BJP has majority on their own. That's what he's trying to convey. His point is, BJP has single-handedly got the majority. They need not rely on their allies at all. Because I still remember Manmohan Singh, when such questions were pointed at Manmohan Singh, saying why this is happening, why you're not taking such decisions. Even though he was the Prime Minister of a coalition government, he had pointed out that I'm not able to do this because of pressure from my coalition partners. Now Congress, earlier when Manmohan Singh was there, Congress might want to do something, but say it's alive, say someone like DMK or TMC, they would say no. So he would not do it. But if he still goes ahead and do it, then TMC or DMK will withdraw the support. This government will fall. This was the compulsion in his government. But what he is trying to tell now is, this Modi government has got majority on its own. They have crossed 300 mark, 304 or something, 282 is a majority mark. So they can single-handedly take decisions on their own, not relying on any partners. Even if some one or two people, allies, withdraw support, the government is still stable. Many people expected a lot more from the budget. What are the main changes? Aadhaar, PAN, fine. And one or two on additional benefits on housing loan repayment, fine. Apart from that, not many benefits or perks given at all. But after 3 years, you can expect many more. Why? Because again, election season will be coming.
Don't you feel that exemption up to 5 lakhs is not a big benefit to the middle income crowd? See, Swami is not admitting himself as, see, it is a big relief. 5 lakhs, up to 5 lakhs, no tax, big relief. See,
but again, one more point to note there is, if you look at this calculation, 2,50,000 to 5 lakh, the calculation is around 12,500. So if you fall under, if your income is exactly 5 lakhs, you would get a maximum benefit of 12,500. But that doesn't mean you are getting the entire 12,000 benefit from this year. You already had a concept of rebate from the previous years. If I'm not wrong, up to 3.5 lakh you had rebate. So you would get around 2,500 or 3,000 or something, I don't remember the exact figure, as rebate, which was already there. So the additional benefit because of this particular measure is only around 9,000 rupees net measure. But again, going by his point, he may not be in the within 5 lakh slab, so it may not impact him directly. But there may be many people. When I filed my return last time, I quoted my income at around 2,60,000 rupees last year. This year I not filed, last year it was 2,60,000 rupees. Now I fall under less than 5 lakh, so benefit is applicable to me. If I can have other benefit, I will have rebate also, so I won't be taxed anyway. What if my income was 4,60,000? Then I would have got the benefit of rebate. So for small taxpayers like me, it will help. The intention was made clear. It is not to help people like your principal, your HODs, your other HODs. It is to help people like me. So poor people.
Sir, this budget is like, I think, being a economics lecturer. A longer promise, shorter ideas.
Exactly, 100%. Because as I told you, if you look at the PDF again, $5 trillion economy, they give you hundreds of points. They have proper vision. But how do we achieve that? It's not planned properly, it's not given at all. Now what happens after 2 years when hopefully Nirmala Sitharaman only prepares and presents the budget, this point will still continue, saying that we'll be a $5 trillion economy by this year, or they'll extend it by 2 more years. The problem is, announcing is one thing. Ideas, long-term ideas, fine. But for you to achieve your long-term ideas, you should plan your short-term well, so that the short-term will contribute to your long-term plans. But if you simply say, after 10 years, I'll own Infosys and keep quietly for next 7 years, will that be okay?
No.
What should you do in that case? if you want to be a good, say, CMD of Infosys, CEO of Infosys, after 10 years, if that is your plan, you should again get into some IT industry, get some experience, prove yourself, and then step by step plan your career properly, you should go there. As he said, long term plans fine, $5 trillion economy, all that, all this is fine. But they have not told us how do we achieve that. Probably there may be one or two cases where they'll say, okay, through that we'll be doing this. But trust me, after when the next budget is presented, this would not have been completed at all. Because I know how government works, I've seen and I've interacted with them, even trained them how to do. In fact, I shouldn't be telling you this, but I went to a lecture on MAT. It's called Minimum Alternate Tax. I mean, it's beyond this, so we won't discuss that. MAT is a concept in income tax where companies have to pay at least this or that. There's some calculation there. I had a session for income tax officers and assistant commissioners of income tax, ACITs, from Bangalore and Telangana, Kerala and Goa, so these four states. I was talking about MAT, and there are few people who started asking me the simplest of doubts possible. I'm not complaining against their doubts. I'm talking about the level of knowledge they have. Because they are the people who send out assessment orders to companies saying that your MAT calculation is wrong. If they don't know what is MAT, what scrutiny will happen? Now, as taxpayers, even chartered accountants, they may go and fool the income tax department saying that this is correct. They simply say, oh, hold on, okay, done. So, I mean, the point here is, even though you have long-term plan, who will implement that? Government officials, do they have required knowledge? Do they have required capabilities? Will private people contribute to that? Do we have enough resources? I think that should be taken care of. Promising is one thing. Do we have the resources to do that? Do we have a proper plan to do that? That is the second thing which they are not addressing. That is my take on that.
So, Modi sir, believing that women are the best financial manager, has assigned this responsibility of FM to Sitaram Madam. But I think she don't know the gravity of an employment situation in the country. When I gone through this budget, I didn't come to know any drastic measures to tackle this unemployment problem. Do you agree, sir?
Again, I completely agree with you. I can quote practical examples as well. The government till date has not admitted that there are unemployment issues. There was a report which came out, but then the report was scrapped before it was made public. But the report was leaked from some source. So there was a report about unemployment, about 2.8 crore or something, I don't know, unemployed people, etc. There was some report about that. Why did this problem of unemployment happen? We can't blame it on the government, but government should accept the fact that there is unemployment and they should tackle it. But the problem which is government is doing it, they are ignoring that particular point, saying there is no unemployment crisis. I mean, the one thing I have against Mr. Modi is when he spoke about, when someone asked him about unemployment question, he gave an answer. He gave a calculation saying, in 1 year, 10,000 chartered accountants will qualify as, people who qualify as chartered accountants. Right? Now, 10,000 chartered accountants, one chartered accountant employs 10 people under him. So, what is 10,000 into 10?
1 lakh.
1 lakh employment generated. Now, is this correct? First of all, will every chartered accountant employ 10 people under him? If he practices, if he continues his CA business, fine. But there are restrictions saying in the first 1 year you have one, next 3 years you can have two or three, then if you have more than experience, more than 10 years, you can take 10 articles. So there are situations like these. So what he did was actually wrong, to cover up the unemployment issue. He even told, if you are changing your vehicle, you are a driver, he had a vehicle, now you are moving on to new vehicle. His point was, because you got a new vehicle, one more job created as driver. What happened to the old job? So it's minus 1 year, plus 1 year, net net it is zero. So he quoted a big list of, you know, employment generated, which actually was completely rubbish. It's not wrong, it's actually rubbish. Because you can't practically think of that thing. He may have the right frame of mind to say, okay, they may get that particular number of employees. This number of employment may be generated. It's all may and contingent. It's the maximum they could achieve. But what is the actual scenario? In fact, when GST was rolled out, even though GST is not part of this, but still, when GST was rolled out, I have seen the problems faced by small vendors. Many small vendors had to shut down their business. And if they shut down the business, are they unemployed? Yes. And when some minister had spoke about pakodas, selling pakodas, that's a valid employment. I'm not against pakodawalas. That's a valid employment. But just because they're selling pakodas doesn't mean you are very good employed people. I mean, the way they covered it up was wrong. Even that will give you some good money. In fact, some last month I saw a report on TV that the GST officers observed on samosa fellow, samosa shopkeeper. Does anyone know about this?
Yes.
See, they observed one full day, 1 or 2 days, they observed on samosa fellow and they told that his income crossed 60 lakh rupees. And they told you have not taken registration on GST, you should pay tax, you should pay penalty, etc., etc. What is reality? That is something secondary. But I'm not against pakadawalas or samosawalas. Even they can make money. But the way they cover up is wrong. To be fair, I've seen, if you can ask me a lot of examples, I can give you examples of how GST has closed down many businesses. In fact, I should not be telling this, but I have advised one of the companies not to transact with non-registered people because it would be a very big problem in their books of accounts. There was a case in, there was a provision in GST where if I'm a registered person, if I have GST registration, if you are selling something to me, right? If you are registered, I am registered, you sell something to me, you will charge GST to me because you are registered under GST Act. If you are registered, you should charge GST to me. So when you charge GST to me, you will give me GST bill, I will make the payment to you, everything is fine. But if I purchase from unregistered people, correct, you are unregistered, you are not registered under GST, you won't charge tax. If I, registered person, purchases from unregistered person, then on behalf of you, I should pay tax to the government. I should raise an invoice to myself, I should pay tax to the government. Now, the client which I was handling, Canfin Homes, I did the complete GST transition to them. They had 144 branches all over India, in 20 states. So I had to file 20 GST returns. I found it very difficult to keep a track of who are unregistered, how do we account it, etc. In fact, I made it eventually. But I gave an advice saying, avoid transactions from unregistered person because the burden will be on registered people. And registered people will not accept additional burden because they already have a lot of responsibilities to handle. So because of such issues, they have to close their business or get registered. If they get registered, they have to pay tax. And again, unnecessary outflow of compliance charges, tax consultant charges, there are a lot of issues there. In fact, to quote a last example, my colleague had called me once. He told me, how long will it take to get a GST registration? I told 15 days max. I asked why, to whom? He told his friend, who provides this mineral 25 liter bottles, bisleri bottles to, see the water cans, not 25 liter cans. He was providing such cans to some IT company, right? So it was happening, they were accepting, payment was done, fine. But after GST, after 2-3 months, the company told him, we cannot give you the payment till you get a GST registration. You are unregistered. We won't make you the payment till you get the GST registration because the burden is on us. We should do the calculation, we should check, find out the rate of tax, we should check something called HSN-SAC code, we should arrive at proper tax, we should prepare a bill, we should give it to you. Lot of complications, we won't be doing this. If you want the payment, get GST registered. Now he has two options. One, either close that business, do some other business, or get registered. So such people, such small taxpayers had to close down their business. Even though the government is not ready to accept, I have seen cases, I have practically seen infamous cases where GST has led to a lot of unemployment issues. As you said, one advantage of Nirmala Sitharaman being finance minister is, she worked as some analyst in PwC. So she has some idea as to how commerce and industry works because PwC is one of the big four in India, in the world. So she has worked there and she has worked some manager and she has got some experience. But that experience will be limited to what the company is offering. If she was in a garment industry or she was in a macro industry, she would have got the entire scale, entire picture. Because her knowledge was restricted, his point is that she is not able to gauge the difficulty of people, the unemployment crisis in the nation. So, yeah, to that point, the point is well taken, I completely agree with that point. From the government's point, they should acknowledge this issue and they should come with a proper solution as to how do we address this issue. I think that is missing from the government.
And very popular scheme as well as the dream of Modi is Swachh Bharat. In the 2018 and 19 budget, the total allocation for this scheme was around 16,000 crores. But for the year 2019 and 20 budget, the allocation has decreased to 12,000. I feel Modi has come to the conclusion that it is not possible.
Or India is already clean.
Or India is already clean. Do you agree, sir?
No, the point there is, because government had come up with Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, they did not have money to, you know, sanction the scheme. So when service tax was there, before GST, GST came into picture on 1st July 2017. Before that, when service tax was there, they collected 0.5% as Swachh Bharat cess. That cess amount was used to distribute it to people. So they had that, and when GST came into picture, that Swachh Bharat cess was taken out. All everything was merged into GST. We have one GST now. So when GST came into picture, and the government had to provide funds from their pocket for Swachh Bharat, they provided. But what one observation with government's policy decision making is, from what I have observed, only when it comes to defense, they'll increase the budget because it's a question of natural pride. If at all, I think around 3 lakh crore is 3 lakh crore, if I'm not wrong, is allocated to the defense. Say 3 lakh crore now. Next year, if they make it 3 lakh 10, 20, it's fine. 3 lakh 50 to 4 lakh, it's fine. If they make it 2 lakh 99,000 crore, people will say, oh, government is not focusing on defense. So only when it comes to defense, the government is a little prudent and it always makes extra provision. But considering the fact that Swachh Bharat came into picture 3-4 years back, and even now, BBMP has banned plastic in Bangalore at least. What extent is success, I don't know. But I got to know yesterday, my mother was telling me that our neighbor's school is not accepting even Tupperware. Tupperware boxes and bottles is not allowed in school. That school is VSS International School, I believe, near my place. They are not allowing plastic products at all. They are asking the students to get steel dabbas. Now, when it was introduced, obviously there would be a lot of expenditure. But gradually, when people come into their senses, when people voluntarily try to help, that is when the allocation, reducing the allocation makes sense. But that no way means that India is becoming cleaner and cleaner. But it is more than the government's intention. It is our mission to keep India clean. Now, if you go to any foreign country, to be fair, the pictures you see will be clean pictures at all. If you go to the slum parts of that country, it will be horrible than India. Like if you go to other countries, probably you will see either the... How many of you have been to Delhi? Well, I have been to Delhi once last year, twice I have been there. There is a posh area where MPs and MLAs say, you think it's you're in some, you know, hi-fi country. You right, go to the next area, you can't even walk there. You walk on garbage. What image of India is portrayed outside? That matters. Now if the slums picture is being showcased outside India, you won't get investments. Or you will get investments to take it out. No, that's like a business altogether. So my point is, in such areas, some slum developing areas, or that should be the point where you should start the transition. Like, you know, I've seen people throw the garbage, sweep it and take photos, calling it Swachh Bharat. That's not Swachh Bharat. Swachh Bharat is go to your drainage, take the silt out of it, take the mud which is stopping the flow of water. That is Swachh Bharat. I think that is not being done. But from the time of its inception, there is 100% improvement.
Yes.
Plastic is being banned. And lot of garbage policies being the wet garbage driver. Ask your mothers, they tell you wet garbage, dry garbage thing has come up now to reduce the, you know, garbage mess, etc. So considering all these, and because it's time that Swachh Bharat Abhiyan was also implemented, a reduction in the amount is justified. But again, that doesn't mean India is cleaner or government is not doing anything. I think it's they have passed on the baton to us to take it forward. That's what I would feel.
Swami sir, any question from students? Sure, we are going to end this session. Yes.
Students question session. So you can ask your own doubts.
Sir. Deepika, yes. You start it.
This time there was a scheme made as study in India to motivate the foreigners to study in India. But what is the use of that when the workers or employees in India itself, they're not getting employment and there is a lot of unemployment problems here?
The fact remains that, again, goes to the, you can say, that goes to the unemployment problem itself. Now, government's intention is to get foreign students. But the problem, if you see, even Indian companies, I've been to many AGMs because I'm shareholders in a few companies. I've been to various AGMs, including Infosys AGM. What the shareholders tell, when the Infosys management tells that we have hired 10,000 people in US, the first question which comes from the shareholders are, when there is a lot of unemployment cases in India, why do you hire people from outside? Indians are no way less than outsiders. The point is there. You know, even if you go to US and UK, most of the doctors are from India only. 80-90% of the doctors are from here. There's no problem with knowledge. The only problem is the unemployment situation. Now, for Infosys, we'll take the same example. There is one place, one job vacancy there. Do you prefer to give it to some local Indian who's unemployed, or do you prefer to give it to some foreigner who comes here and takes the money and takes it back to his place? Logically, it should go to the Indian. But again, government is saying that, okay, we have that facility. It's just telling people that we have these many opportunities open. So again, agree to your point, that should not be the case, because if Indians earn, it will contribute to India's GDP. If that fellow earns, he'll take the money and go back. So India is no way, you know, benefited from it. So, I mean, it's just a provision there, but how successful will that be, and considering the unemployment situation in India, that is to be seen. Probably by next year's budget, that point will be deleted itself. There won't be any mention of such points maybe.
Apart from that, the intention of it is, only we are giving education. We are not
assured
to be
applied.
Second question.
Good afternoon, sir. So, from past few years, we have seen cases of people taking loan and just escaping. So, what are the schemes for this year from this budget to revive banking sector? Because there is a lot of loss for banking sector because people just take loans and they just move away from the country, and there's a lot of loss for banking sector. So how is this budget helpful for those banking sectors?
So this current year, the government has, even I think the latest notification, there is something called NBFCs, non-banking financial institutions. They're not banks, but they're financial institutions. So they come under Housing Board, National Housing Board, NHB. They don't come under RBA. Banks come under RBA, NBFCs come under NHB, National Housing Board. The problem is, if you take a loan from a non-banking financial company and you don't repay, then you are bound by the terms of NHB. Government, I think I saw a notification yesterday that government has proposed, I think it is passed in the parliament also, if I'm not wrong, they want NBFCs also to come under RBA. So, adding on to your point, the measures taken by the government, last 2 years back when Raghuram Rajan, the governor, was there, he proposed one scheme where if there is any default in any bank, that should be brought to the notice of RBI first. Not in the process of completely defaulting. There are three levels of classification as default. Level 1, level 2 and level 3. Whatever goes to level 1, you notify. There is some limit. If it crosses the limit, notify. Crosses level 2, notify again. Crosses level 3, notify again. So government is having a watch of people who are either defaulting or in the process of about to default, or they've already defaulted. They have a list, so they'll start proceedings accordingly. Now what happens in SBI, at least they have done audit of SBI also. All the branches you see, say you have a branch in SBI, you default in paying the money back. Those people won't come to you. The bankers, that branch people won't come to you. That particular account, your account will be transferred to one specific account, which is right in front of our office. Stressed Asset Management, SAM branch is called, SAM branch, Stress Asset Management branch. They, on behalf of all the branches, they have agents to collect, they get the collections done. How is this possible? Because banks are taking initiative one, and they are forced to do by RBA. So till earlier, RBA used to get only when the banks got that he is defaulted. But from when Rajan introduced that particular part, he made sure whoever has taken loan, if it crosses this limit, and as I told you, three levels of defaults, as soon as it crosses, RBI will get notified and RBI will start taking action along with the banks immediately. And from this year, NBFCs also will also be part of banks, so more safety to the banking thing.
Thank you so much, sir. Now, I request to
Kiran Kumara.
Kiran, just come here.
Praveen, how are you?
Kiran. It's a time to honor our chief guest, Mr. Shashanka. I request Principal Sir to hand over a small memento to our chief guest to honor him. I would like to call Mr. Praveen, lecturer in commerce, to render oath of thanks.
Good afternoon. The best and the most beautiful things in the world cannot be seen or even touched. They must be felt with the heart. Helen Keller. I deem it a great honor and privilege to propose the oath of thanks on this occasion. Let me first of all start by giving glory to the Almighty God for making today's occasion a resounding success. Today, my words are not enough to express the gratitude on behalf of Sandhariya Educational Trust. I would like to thank our today's chief guest, Mr. Shashank Bhatt, co-founder and trainee at Staxo Academy. I thank you, sir. Who graced us with his thoughts provoking address set a perfect platform for our college. Thank you, sir. I take this opportunity to express thanks to our beloved principal, sir, for his support, vision, and commitment in this function. Thank you, sir. In our absence, I'd like to thank our vice principal for our guidance and presence in this occasion. I would like to thank Narasimha Swami Sir, HOD of Economics Department, for his excellent involvement in live discussion with today's chief guest. Thank you, sir. I'd also like to thank our beloved HOD Usharani Madam, Commerce Department, for her support and guidance. Thank you, ma'am. I would like to thank Mr. Kiran Kumar Sir, lecturer in commerce and coordinator of business club, and my colleagues for their valuable contribution in today's program. Last but not the least, I thank these students for your active involvement in participating and making the event successful. Thank you once again.